Ontario's Premier says it's time for the Liberal Party to renew its leadership. We've been discussing this subject online since 7:15 this evening, and we're continuing the live chat now on our homepage. That's theagenda.tvo.org, and on Twitter, that's hashtag AgendaTVO. Chime in, let us know your thoughts on Dalton McGuinty's departure and the new direction for the Liberals and possibly the province. Joining us in studio now to debate the good, the bad, and the ugly of the McGuinty legacy, Greg Cerbera, the recently retired former finance minister and MPP for Vaughan; John Duffy, longtime Liberal advisor, principal at Strategy Corp; Tim Murphy, former MPP, former Ontario Liberal Party president, currently partner at Macmillan LLP; and Maria Babbage, legislative reporter for the Canadian Press, covering Ontario politics. Good to see all of you this evening. We want to remind our viewers that while three of you are Liberals here, Maria, of course, the neutral observer, we will have opposition reaction throughout the course of the program. We don't want everybody to think this is a big Liberal love-in tonight.
Why not?
Well, here we go.
Once a year.
Once a year. Greg, you knew him, I think it's fair to say, better than anybody at this table, so I want to start with you.
Yeah.
Why did he leave now?
Well, I think the answer to that is real simple. I think that the minority government, the reality of a minority government meant that there could be an election at any time, particularly given the poisoned atmosphere in the legislature. So I think the premier simply searched his soul and asked himself the question, do I want to lead this party into the next campaign?
And
if you say no, you must leave, and you actually have to leave right away. Because if Parliament resumes, and given that atmosphere, there's a vote of non-confidence, then you're right into an election, and then you have to leave. He has worked so hard, really, over the past 22 years, and certainly the past nine as Premier, and I think he just did not feel enough energy to say, I'm going to take my party into the next campaign.
Did it look to you, Maria, like, I mean, you're at the legislature every day, you watch this guy, you go to his press conferences, you go to his events, you watch him in question period. Did he look like the gas was running low in the tank?
No. Actually, a few weeks ago, he was at George Brown College and talking about how he would lead the party in the next election. So it was a big surprise. I think there were a lot of difficulties that he was facing over the last few weeks. The contempt charge over the gas plant documents and the Orange Air Ambulance committee meetings and the scandal that's been growing from that particular issue. But I don't think anyone really expected for him to step down.
Did this catch you by surprise?
A little bit. I think the timing did. I mean, what's interesting is there, you know, I mean, some of the people who were close to him, obviously Greg is one of them, were, you know, some of them had left to move on to other things, including people like Greg, in fact. But, you know, what I heard and from the people I talked to was that he had, you know, in his mind the possibility he would go and advance in the next election. It was on his mind in a way it hadn't been before any other election. And that he felt a responsibility to allow, you know, an opportunity for a new leader to come in and do that. And what I think his initial time frame was longer, frankly. And as the reality of the, you know, of the minority parliament, as Greg said, descended, and in particular the likelihood that the government in the current incarnation could not survive the next budget, he looked out there, he kind of had to make the decision now as to whether to stay or go. And I think having faced that, he said, look, I got to go, and the responsible time to go is now, to give a party a time to elect a new leader, and the new leader time to put together a budget, a throne speech, and face the legislature.
John, catch you off guard?
Yeah, sure, a little bit. But I agree with Tim that you could sort of sense, and with Maria and with Greg, you could sort of sense the decision starting to have to be made, the timeline of the life of the government being foreshortened by the descent of the parliament into unworkability. And then there's a human factor. Thanksgiving is a funny time. And these things sort of tend to happen around periods of family reflection.
It's happened three times lately, hasn't it?
Yeah, I remember. Well, I remember Bill Davis and Thanksgiving back in 1984.
Mike
Harris on Thanksgiving. So there may be a sort of walk among the cranberries that these guys take this time of year, among the leaves. you know, it's a time for reflection, and we can't ignore the human element, because when your pathway and your party's pathway to do the things that you're there to do is blocked, you can either call an election, or if you're not sure you want to lead on that, you start thinking about your family, and there you are at the table, and suddenly it all gets very clear, and you say the things that he said, I thought, with great dignity and appropriateness yesterday.
He did mention his daughter's wedding. His daughter's his oldest of four, and that when he went to that wedding, it kind of all came home to him.
You know, Steve, I had a long chat with him just before the announcement, and so I'm disagreeing with Maria. I don't think the current assault in Parliament had anything to do with this at all. I think he realized, not that maybe a budget next year wouldn't pass, but that we could get back into Parliament and there could be a non-confidence motion within days of the return of Parliament. Then you're faced with a situation where you must lead the party in the next campaign. And in that chat, I could just hear his desire to have a post-political life. Talked about the kids, talked about Terry, talked about what he might do.
Absolutely. Talked about what he might do.
Well,
because he said he had no plans.
No, he said he didn't have any plans, but he talked about, you know, I'm going to have to figure out what I'm going to do. But the yearning, and I know about that because I went through that, the yearning to have a private life after a long political career. Never once mentioned, the terror of this Parliament and the kind of poisonous atmosphere there. So I can only talk about, what happened in that conversation. I didn't hear one word about trying to avoid anything.
Tim, help us with this. This guy got elected. I mean, you were with him at the beginning, right?
Yep.
You were the president of the party when he was running in that first election in 1999. Not particularly well, but well enough to hang on to his job.
Yep.
He got
alone is an achievement, frankly.
Right on.
These current times.
He got elected because he wanted to rebuild the health and education aspects of our province.
Absolutely.
That's not the job today. The job today, as he's identified it, is to figure out how to implement an austerity agenda so we get out from under a $14 billion plus deficit. Could it be that he just didn't have the stomach for that anymore after being in politics 22 years?
I'm sure it couldn't have been easy. I think, frankly, he did an excellent job in healthcare and education. Came in saying those were going to be the signature initiatives. I mean, we worked with him when I was with Paul Martin federally on healthcare and wait times, and he was a leader in that regard, and clearly in Ontario and education. And I think, obviously, it's difficult to then turn around on people you've built together with, you know, the teachers and other significant stakeholders in the system, to have to go to them and say, you know, we have to share in this pain, and then have to fight with them kind of on a daily basis. So that can't be easy. Now, that being said, I mean, I heard him, you know, speak. He did the Drummond thing, and I heard him speak on the notion of this is a responsibility we bear towards our children. I mean, one of the things that is, I think, was initially deceptive, but is very appealing about Dalton as a politician, is that he's genuine. That people see in him someone who actually believes in what he's doing, comes to it without a lot of ego, oddly enough. And I think that he believed he was doing something right for the province in trying to get the finances in order. But it had to, you know, strike him every day that he was having to, you know, beat back a little bit of his own achievements to do this very important task.
I want to pick up on Drummond with you, because, yes, he appointed Don Drummond, the former Deputy Minister of Finance, to go give him a roadmap to get to a balanced budget. He accepted the report, and then he promptly ignored some of the key recommendations that would have helped him balance the budget. Did it look to you like he just didn't have the stomach to do some of this heavy cutting that he thinks is necessary?
It's a very difficult job, and I don't think any political leader relishes the idea of spending the next few years having people angry at you for, you know, freezing their wages and cutting their benefits. I think it must have been very trying for him to have seen that with the Ontario teachers, who were one of his most powerful allies, have helped him, helped his campaigns financially, have put out volunteers to help him get elected. I don't think that was easy. I'm not sure how much of that, you know, was part of the calculation to leave, but I think it certainly didn't help if it wouldn't have made him want to stay on, at least. But, you know, he's handled a lot of difficult problems before. I'm not sure that tackling this austerity agenda would necessarily have scared him off. He's done made a lot of difficult decisions, gone back on promises because he thought it was the right thing to do. So I'm not sure if it's that so much as he felt it was the right time to go, that it was time for the party to start anew, because, you know, things were just not going nowhere.
I want to follow on the teachers. He had excellent relations with the teacher unions, whom he called his partners in education, for 8 of his 9 years. This year has not been good. Can you help us understand why, you know, Brian Mulroney had that old expression, right? You got to dance with the one that brung you. He hasn't done that. He's really kind of turned on the ones that he brung. What's going on there?
I think the minority parliament, the major minority, has so much to do with this, and the supercharged political situation, particularly with two opposition parties that I think believe that they'd like to see an election and believe that they'd do well out of it. And this is how our system works. But what it means is that when you've got that kind of atmosphere and you're on the razor's edge in Parliament every day, the ability to take the time and to build the consensuses and to organize the support for creative approaches to changing healthcare and changing education in ways that actually don't just degenerate into pure cost cutting. The amount of time and space you've got to do that really gets constrained by the minority parliament. I think there's a lot to be said for the thesis that this parliament made doing liberal versions of those changes and reforms very, very difficult. And so it makes sense to reshuffle the deck and to deal the cards again. And I think a leadership change is a really important part of that. I think there's an exciting debate to happen about broadening the agenda from what sometimes appears to be just cut, 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 trying to bring back groups and reach out to new people and get new energy and new ideas and new creativity. I hope the opposition will show some of that. I'm encouraged, for example, that Tim Hudak is starting to show more policy than he did in the run-up to the last election. I'm hoping that Andrea Horwath will do some of that. I think there's an opportunity for some real creativity and positive change here. That's what I'm hoping to see coming out of the months ahead.
Okay, sit tight, everybody, because you mentioned Tim Hudak, and a little earlier today, actually about an hour ago, he was in that chair right there, and we talked about what's going on. So let's get some more reaction to the extraordinary developments at Queen's Park, starting with our conversation of about an hour ago with the Leader of the Opposition. Here's Tim Hudak. Tim, welcome back to TVO. Nice to see you again.
Thanks for being back on the show.
First question, was Dalton McGuinty a good premier?
Straight out, eh? Well, I'm going to say no. I'm going to be generous here. I mean, here's where he was successful. He won three elections. To his credit, anybody in politics should admire success. I think that is the winningest liberal since Oliver Mowat.
126 years.
There you go, back at the end of the 19th century. But I think he is now leaving a province in decline, deeply in debt, shedding private sector jobs, and in a cloud of scandal. My answer to the question is no. He won elections, but I think he left the province worse off than when he found it.
What do you think proroguing the legislature, as he has done, will do to his legacy?
I'd worry about that if I were him. I just don't think he would want to leave as one of his last major decisions as premier. That he basically walked away from the job and then, if you will, turned off the lights in the legislature. I mean, we're at a crucial tipping point in this province. Our economy is in trouble. We're in a debt crisis. We're spending $1.8 million more every hour than we take in revenue. We've got this ongoing issue with the gas plants and others. I don't know if Dalton McGuinty truly wants to make part of his legacy that when the going got tough, not only did he walk away, but he basically closed down our ability to get things done to resolve the problems he's left behind.
Why do you think he did it then?
I think that he took the decision seriously to leave. That's not one that you take lightly. I had a conversation with Terry. I will say that, I sit across from the house there every day, back and forth. I think the fire in the belly had been extinguished. I just didn't see it there.
That's a bit harsh.
Well, is that
extinguished?
Too harsh? Okay. Had petered out somewhat. I'll be a bit more general. I just didn't see the fire there, and the legislative agenda was pretty mild. So it didn't surprise me that he was considering leaving. I would not have guessed middle of October. I thought maybe Christmas time. It did surprise me, though, that you would prorogue the legislature, take all the bills and committee hearings and basically kick them down the road or end them. And I think that what this reflects is a premier who's more worried about his reputation and that of the Liberal Party than the interests of taxpayers who expect us to work on creating jobs and balancing the books. So he clearly put the future of the Liberal Party, their interests, ahead of what he should have done, and that's the interest of the province as a whole.
Well, let's look into his explanation, which was, in part, I think, he wants to do a deal with you, and he thinks there's a more likely opportunity to find some common ground with you if the daily pressures of question period, et cetera, lower the temperature a little bit. Maybe they can find some common ground with you guys.
I don't buy that. I mean, you know this. It's basic politics. If you actually want to get through some legislation, like a wage freeze, for example, the legislature has to be in session by definition. Just because we have question period an hour a day doesn't mean that all work grinds to a halt otherwise. I wish that... I think there'd be a better way of going out for him than inventing this excuse that somehow he has to end the legislature so he can negotiate on something that needs the legislature in the first place. I think unfortunately, there'll be many things that he's proud of in his legacy, no doubt, and liberals will be as well. I think it's a big mistake for him to leave as a lasting part of that legacy that he walked away from the job, that he closed down the legislature at a time that's really a tipping point in the history of our province when it comes to the economy and debt.
What do you think he got right?
I mean, he executed his agenda. I mean, I think you saw changes. I think Dalton McGuinty would be seen as somebody who was usually underestimated and then succeeded. And in 2003, when he defeated then Premier Eaves, he had a very clear agenda of what he wanted to do around things like energy, education, health. And I think probably if you look, there are a lot of broken promises on the fiscal issues, but there'll be things that he said he campaigned on and that he accomplished. I think we see now at the end of those 9 years in office a very different man, a different set of priorities than when he first began back in 2003.
Okay, let me try this one. If he's such a dud, how did he beat Ernie Eaves, John Tory, and Tim Hudak?
I'm not saying that. I admire his success. He's a good politician and a successful one. And I don't mean that in a pejorative sense at all. I mean that as a compliment. He won. He passed Mitch Hepburn on the Liberal Hall of Fame, if you will, and in the fields of the mullet. So I know I respect that level of success. I don't mean to besmirch that in any way. Obviously, as a conservative, I have a very different view on how you take on the big issues in the province and issues that are of concern to families right now. When it comes to things like creating jobs, where the private sector in Ontario has gone compared to where we've been historically, the fact that we have thrown money at problems for so long that now we are on the verge of tripling our provincial debt. I don't see that as legacy success. He won elections, no doubt a talented politician, should be proud of that record. I just have a very strong disagreement with the priorities that he chose as premier.
Okay. When you heard that he wanted to prorogue the legislature, no more question period, no more committee hearings, all of that shuts down. Did you and your people have a conversation amongst yourself which went something like this? I wonder if we can go to the Lieutenant Governor and ask him to unprorogue. Did you guys think about doing that, going to the LG and seeing if we could get things back in business?
No, I mean, no, the answer is no. I mean, that did occur later on. People suggested that. I think that the Lieutenant Governor had signed the document and the House was prorogued. So the answer is no to the question. We had to respond quickly, and I went and did a press conference, I think an hour or so after the Premier made his announcement. But I will tell you, I was surprised at the prorogation decision. Certainly there were rumors around that. But I remember sitting, you know, proudly as a member of Mike Harris's cabinet. It was similarly October of 2001, I believe, when he announced his resignation, that he would resign as Premier. But we stayed on. The cabinet continued to function. We took questions in the legislature. We actually paid down provincial debt, and then he handed the baton to his successor, Premier Eaves. I thought we'd see something like that, a handoff, but not a closure of the legislature and end to any kind of business in the House.
Mind you, Stephen Harper did it twice, right? And one time to avoid the noose. So it's everybody does it.
It's a tool, I guess, that premiers or prime ministers have used at different times. Mm-hmm. Just the combination of relinquishing the job as premier and not allowing somebody else to carry it forward, not allowing any activity in the legislature. I don't know how often this has happened, where a leader, premier, prime minister steps down and prorogues the House. I mean, it's all very procedural, but here's what's important. There are 600,000 women and men today who will wake up tomorrow with no job to go to. There's a lot of young women and young men who have their college diplomas, their university degrees, a trade certificate, who are back on mom and dad's couch, that they're hoping for more opportunity to have moved out by now. It's incumbent upon us to work hard for those folks, to work on the economy, to balance the books. I think proroguing the legislature and ending business for Lord knows how many months is a disservice to those people and is going to hurt the province at a very crucial time.
Not that you don't always give me serious answers to serious questions, but I want you to go particularly deep on this one and give me a serious answer to this question. Do you care who replaces McGuinty as premier?
I haven't thought about it that much. You know, ultimately, I don't know if it matters that much. We'll see what horses line up at the gate.
Why doesn't it matter?
Well, I mean, all of them are going to have to, unless somebody comes in from the outside, they're all going to have to defend the record. They were all part of the decisions to put us deeply in debt, decisions that were anti-job creation that have slowed our economy significantly. I guess we'll see what direction they go. If people reject that legacy, I sense that they won't. I think a lot of my fate and that of the PC caucus will rest instead in this fact. The importance of us laying out an alternative conservative plan, not simply saying what they did wrong, but what's that PC vision? What's our plan to actually grow the economy? And a lesson learned, quite frankly, the hard way from the last campaign, but we've been doing that, and you've been kind enough to come to our events. Now, 4 white papers, most recently, the Agenda for Growth, 15 bold ideas to fire up our private sector to get Ontario as a leader again in job creation. I think, you know, our future as a party, my future as a potential premier, rests more so with the path that we take. We're laying that out piece by piece, brick by brick.
But it's a normal human emotion to look across the floor of the legislature every day and say, I think I can beat that guy. That person might be tougher to beat. This person, no sweat. I mean, you don't have those private thoughts?
You know what? Probably will. I guess when I see the horses that line up, beating that horse analogy to death. But I guess when I see who actually puts their name in, that might cross my mind. It's 24 hours, Steve. I haven't really thought about that. I may do that when the time comes. Honest to God, I think that my fate is going to be in my hands out of the PC caucus to lay out that alternative. I think people are looking for a better way.
Let me do one more question with you here. And of course, the history wonk that I am, you'll know what's coming. No rookie leader in the province of Ontario has won a majority government in 41 years, Bill Davis being the last one. The next Liberal leader in the province of Ontario will be a rookie leader. You will not be. You will have had one under your belt. Does that make your path to the premier's chair a little easier?
I remember you threw that question at me before the last election campaign. So I was going to beat that trend. Now I'm hoping to keep that trend going. There's no doubt that if you don't sort of walk through that fire, it is an important proving ground. And I think only those that have been through the campaign know what it's going to be like. I had an impression, like I said, an academic view of what it was like. Until you actually go through reality, is different. I've been through the fire. I've learned lessons. I'm proud that I added 16 MPPs, but I want to do a lot better. And I think you're seeing the changes that we've made as a result of that. It is a test, and there's some skilled individuals, no doubt, that will line up in the Liberal Party. I'll respect what they bring to the table. But my plan, Steve, is to keep that streak going.
That's Opposition Leader Tim Hudak. Thanks for coming into TVO tonight.
Pleasure's mine.
Okay, let's pick up on our conversation back here in the studio. I want to remind everybody that you can, I hope, enhance your enjoyment of this broadcast tonight by going onto our website. That's theagenda.tvo.org. We've got a live chat happening there right now, so chime in and share your thoughts at #AgendaTVO. Greg Sorbera, let me pick up on something that was referenced in that conversation. Do you think that Dalton McGuinty has negatively or adversely affected his legacy because he's prorogued Parliament?
No, absolutely not. I mean, I have a great deal of respect for Tim, and he sounded very sincere. But listening to him, it just honestly, Steve, drives me to distraction. He talked about, you know, there are huge problems in unemployment, and it's very important for Parliament to be at work to deal with those problems. This is the guy who along with Andrea Horwath, has taken up 98% of the Parliament's time over the past 3 weeks in one issue, trying to destroy the character of one honourable member, Chris Bentley. The Energy Minister. There's been nothing else that's gone on, not because we were not willing to bring forward matters, but because they, as opposition parties, decided that that was the most important issue. So, I mean, I think prorogation was the right approach here because sometimes it's just important to push the pause button, particularly when the atmosphere of that legislature had become so poisoned. And again, the reality is that had the Parliament not been prorogued, they may well have brought forward a non-confidence motion, which would have resulted in an election, something that nobody I know in this province is really anxious to proceed with.
Tim, one of the questions I got on the live chat before we went on the air tonight was, did the Premier have any other options other than proroguing Parliament? Did he?
I don't think practically he did. I agree with Greg. I just think it's a non-story. I mean, we've all learned from Stephen Harper that there is a fairly high degree of willingness to tolerate all kinds of parliamentary shenanigans without it having any effect on the person. We had Stephen Harper called an election despite the fact he passed fixed date election laws, prorogued Parliament to avoid defeat in the House, and no one cared. He won the next election. So there's that. Secondly, what I saw from Tim Hudak and see from Andy Horwath are two opposition leaders who actually are dealing with everything very politically right now, and that's part of the challenge in the legislature and facing the policy agenda. I mean, I hear language, as Greg said, about we need to face this issue and that issue, but it's all done from a political lens, not a substantive lens, that we need to get some things done in the legislature. So you kind of say, well, what's the point of a legislature if it's going to focus on, frankly, advancing political interests as opposed to policy interests? Now, I think that's going to be a frustration for Dalton over the next number of months, too, because he's going to try and put together, you know, reach out to, as he said, to the others to see what it can do. I think they're not going to listen.
I think that's
And I think that's going to be a challenge. And you know, there is a challenge always in leadership where you've got, you know, existing cabinet ministers out campaigning and creating new policy areas. And I think all of which would create a challenge in a minority parliament that's probably just better not to face. And frankly, I would say that most Ontarians won't notice.
Won't notice because this is all inside baseball and
yes.
They don't care. They're leading real lives. They're
exactly.
not abnormal people like us around
exactly.
this table.
Exactly. And, you know, the teachers are in school. The classes are there. You know, people aren't on strike. You know, they live their lives. They'll pay their taxes. And that's, they won't notice this. They'll say, Dalton did a pretty good job. He's moved on. I'll pay attention again when they have a new leader and something forces me to.
Is there any question in your mind, John, that the House was prorogued in large part to save the skin of the energy minister, whom the premier believes is getting an unfair rap from the opponents?
I don't see it that way. I think the magnitude of events has dwarfed that. Listening to people on the street today, they are talking about, they're very surprised. They're surprised that McGuinty's moving on. You can get them to prorogation if you talk about the mechanics of it, but mostly that's not what they care about. The other thing that I think is important to understand here is that this prorogation is perfectly constitutionally legitimate. It is unconstitutional to prorogue after a government has fallen. That would put us into a crisis. It is pushing it really hard to prorogue when the confidence of the House has been called into question by votes. There is nothing anywhere in a British Westminster system that suggests it's wrong to prorogue at this point.
But it looks like he's trying to avoid the contempt process, which was going to go through a legislative committee.
It may to some, and some may want to play that up, but I think the magnitude of what has happened here vastly outweighs that. And if there's a sense that there was a political price that was supposed to be paid for any of this, for heaven's sake, I can't imagine a major change like this not meeting that bill in full. So I'm just not sensing this issue outside of the rounds of excellent programs such as the agenda was too big. Where I am hearing a lot of this, I'll be honest.
How it saves Bentley either, truthfully. He still has the prospect of this. You know, it's been prorogued in the face of that impending problem. It's going to be a little cloud, totally unfairly, but a cloud that hangs over him and will impact, I think, his decision around leadership. He may still run, but, you know, if he runs and faces a new parliament, you can well imagine that Andrea Horwath and Tim Hudak will be bringing that issue before parliament again.
Maria, what's your reporting telling you on this?
On the prorogation?
Yes.
Well, it does three things. I mean, politics aside, it does three things. It gives him some time to have a leadership race for the Liberals to choose a new leader. It also gives the party time to sort of mend fences with the unions, which is, you know, as they saw in the last by-election, was a very serious threat to re-election.
Not in Vaughan, just in Kitchener.
Exactly. And it also gives them time to, do those things, but also it wipes clean the slate on the contempt motion. Now, whether or not it was an attempt to avoid a decision on that in the legislature, avoid the committee calling Bentley before to testify, or whether it was to simply get rid of that mess and wipe it off the slate, I don't know, but it does do that. And so when you're looking at what calculation may have gone into proroguing, that those three things are part of it, I think.
Okay. Let's get some insight from Greg Saber here, who's run a bunch of the Liberal campaigns and, again, knows the Premier very well. His first election win was 2003, and yeah. I think, you know, we'd had 9 years of Conservatives before that. People were probably ready for change, obviously.
Much better party president by that point, too.
Not true.
Meaning he was in and you were out.
Yes.
That's very self-deprecating of you. But by the next time round, 2007, he looked like he was going to lose, mm-hmm. but he won.
Yeah.
John Tory helped him with the full funding for religious schools issue. By 2011, he looked like he was going to lose. He was 15 points down going
yep.
into that election
yep.
campaign.
Yep. Yep.
Help us understand what this guy apparently has that his critics may not want to acknowledge that allowed him to win three in a row when that looked utterly impossible to do.
Steve, I think it's about stability of character just a deeply rooted sense of integrity and mission. I tell people that, you know, I have been working with Dalton sort of nonstop since 1999. I have never seen him lose his temper. I have never seen him just blow off the handle. He is just as steady as anyone I have ever seen and focused on the mission. He puts it in simple terms, never too high, never too low. But it's his sense of purpose and his determination. And again, this of this whole business of prorogation is all about saying, you know what? We got some really important things to do with dealing with public sector trade unions. Parliament has been poisoned. I'm going to get on with that work. And at the same time, I'm going to give my own party a little bit of breathing space to choose a new leader to continue down that road. But it's that stability of character, and I've always been in awe of it.
At the 1996 Leadership Convention at Maple Leaf Gardens,
yep.
Who were you supporting going into that?
Nobody. I had tried to back away very far from politics, and a lot of dear friends were running, and I just decided to stay away.
Tim, who are you supporting?
Well, just but I, Friday night, I went to the convention, listened to the speeches, and said, Dalton McGuinty has the capacity to grow into a great premier.
That's why I asked, because yeah. I remember you with a McGuinty button on it.
Oh, yeah, yeah, but I put it on Friday night.
Who are you with?
I said Dwight Duncan and then Dalton on the last ballot.
Dalton on the last ballot. John, were you a delegate at that one?
I was neutral.
You were neutral.
That's right. And I was as surprised
collecting
as
fees,
anybody. I wanted to start a draft Tim Murphy movement, and I still want to do that tonight, yeah. but maybe... No, you couldn't see it coming unless you really knew the guy, and not as many people outside caucus knew Dalton McGuinty in 1996. But I think what Greg's touching on is fundamental. You know, we live in a period of time when political operators are no longer the people out front. It's really important that the person not only project authenticity and sincerity and commitment, but that actually be the real person. And I think what Greg's talking about is absolutely true. This is a guy who went into politics because he believes that, you know, we all know the signature lines of Dalton McGuinty, that, you know, no one gets left behind in a family, and we're a family. So that means you got to make sure that every kid gets a good education, okay, and that they have decent health care so no one loses the house. That really is the guy.
But the reason I'm asking this question is because, you know, I don't think anybody after that convention was over thought to themselves, wow, this guy's fantastic. He's going to take us to the promised land.
At 6 o'clock in the morning, people were willing to believe anything. That was a long night.
That's a good
night.
Point. It was a long night.
I want to just add to that, Steve, because I became party president, succeeded my dear friend Tim Murphy in 1999. And for 2 years, I had people say to me, come on, Greg, Dalton McGuinty,
yeah.
Premier, you are dreaming in Technicolor. And my response was simple. I said, just watch him. This is going to happen.
His first campaign wasn't very good, 1999 against Mike Harris.
Well, yes and no, actually. I mean, to be fair, you know, Mike Harris and the Conservatives spent a lot of money in the advance of that. I mean, a lesson since learned. But, you know, framing Dalton in a way that made it very challenging. As you say, the history is for rookie leaders have a very difficult mm-hmm. time winning that first election. I mean, if you'd taken 10,000 votes and put it across the province in the right way, there would have been a minority parliament. So it's, you know, to lose badly is I understand he didn't, you know, Harris won the seat count was not right, but the votes weren't that far
five
apart
points
from
different.
That. Yeah. And so that all being said, you know, I mean, I think the first and most important skill of a successful politician is luck. Mm-hmm. And Dalton's had the luck of some very astute opposition. But that being said, you know, when I think about the way voters look and assess politicians, the first thing they say is there empathy in that person? Do they understand where I come from? And then secondly, they say, do I trust this person to make the decision? Because everyone's fairly, they understand they're not going to be able to make the decision themselves. Can I trust this person to make a decision that I can more or less live with, that they will bring into account factors that I think are appropriate and do the best they can? And I think Dalton's fundamental political skill is to be very good on both of those. You know, he's a genuine person, and people see that genuine character in him. And I think that's been an important thing as he's taken on people like, you know, Ernie Eves and John Tory and Tim Hudak.
There's just one quick thing I want to flag, and that's the quality of the team that he put together around him. One of the best teams in Canadian politics, election in, election out. Greg and Tim, you did a lot to build that team, and it remains a very formidable group of people, even through all the years. The ability to build and hold and continue to hold a team of that quality is pretty important.
Lest we think that he can walk on water, I want to bring us a little bit back to reality.
He knows where the stones are, yeah.
he had a lot of missteps along the way.
Absolutely.
One of the first things he did was hire his brother.
Absolutely.
And then had to fire him because it didn't play well. And he appointed Joe Cordiano deputy leader and then had to fire him. And there were numerous missteps like this along the way.
Yep.
There were riding fights among members. You know, we look at him today as a guy who won three elections in a row, but we can't always say that that was a slam dunk. He had a lot of, you know, misery along the way. Maria, I want to ask you, from having watched him on the last campaign, the guy you saw out there on the last campaign was a mature, you know, obviously very expert campaigner. What did it look like he was bringing to the party that made him go in 15 points down thinking, I can win this thing?
I'm not sure. I mean, it's a very good question. The polling was not very good before the campaign. But I think he, you know, put a lot of faith in a formula that's worked very well for the Liberals. And he projected stability. He sort of cast the opposition as, you know, the unstable element that was going to hurt Ontario at a time where it needed to recover economically. That the Conservatives might hurt the public services, that the NDP weren't ready for government. So I think what he brought was the history of being in power for so many years and being the guy that says, look, I know how to do these things. Keep me on because I can do them.
I actually think he did something. I disagree a little bit. I actually think he did something that was a little more significant. And one of the things that you saw and the team around him saw was that Ontario voters suffer from the problem is they don't actually pay much to Ontario politics until the election comes. And what was clear was that, and as we've noted, right, Dalton had a significant record of achievement in healthcare and education, you know, results of kids in school, a reduction in waiting lists, and Ontarians had no idea. Right, they just hadn't seen. They like people went in and experienced all the progress, but as voters, they hadn't seen it. And so what he did was actually interesting. In a world where almost every campaign is negative, he actually ran a positive one. You look at the advertising; there's lots of very positive. Here's our achievements. And as Ontarians came to say, "Hey, you know what? Actually, he's done quite a good job." The numbers started to move. For you know, and I think then both Hudak and particularly Hudak kind of made some mistakes that helped. But at the end of the day, he said to Ontarians, here's what we've done for you. And they said, hey, you know what? The guy I know and like actually did do a good job. He deserves another shot.
John.
I want to elaborate on what Tim's saying and what Maria's saying, because I think it's really important. There was, I can't believe I'm talking about Dalton McGuinty as premier in the past tense, but there was to McGuinty's campaigns, maybe not so much the first one where he couldn't get past the attacks on his ability to lead, an uplift to them, and not just optimism that was in choose change and making life just a little bit better and forward together. Those are good thematics, but he always was able to lift the debate to a slightly higher level, to a level of where we want to be as a province, where do families want to be living within here. There was the ability to cast it higher, and you never saw that more than that, an amazing 15-point comeback in 2011 when no one was talking about the economy. And in about May, Dalton McGuinty started talking about the economy and jobs and growth, which was the issue that was on everybody's mind. And he had the right message to lift people's eyes up from the negativity and the mess in the legislature and all the other things that bedevil you, and keep everyone's eye on the prize. He had an amazing ability to lift up the dialogue and the discourse to where people actually wanted to connect to his optimism, as Tim is describing.
I'm going to play some tape now from one person whose vote I don't think he got. Here's our conversation from earlier today with the leader of the third party in Ontario politics, her reaction to Dalton McGuinty's departure, and if prorogation was the right way to leave. Andrea Horwath. Andrea Horwath, leader of Ontario's NDP and the member for Hamilton Centre. Welcome back.
Thank you, Steve.
Okay, first and foremost, do you think Dalton McGuinty's been a good premier for Ontario?
You know, I think Dalton McGuinty's done what he thought was the right thing for Ontario. Many, many things I disagreed with, although you'll know that there are things that I supported in terms of some of his initiatives. At the bottom line, or the end of the day, the thing you remember is that he worked hard, that he was dedicated, he was passionate, and that he dedicated a lot of time and a lot of commitment, and that's something I think everybody needs to respect.
He has prorogued the legislature. What do you think that will do to his legacy as people consider that?
Well, I think that's the most unfortunate story coming out of last night's announcement, is that he went out in a bit of a cloud with the prorogation. I don't believe there was a necessity to prorogue the House. I think that they were certainly setting up a scenario whereby they could justify a prorogation. But look, at a lot of the stalling of things in the legislature was directly because the government chose not to put committees together, and they chose not to be quick off the mark to get the committee that was supposed to look at the gas plants put in place. And so you can't, on the one hand, say we can't get anything done in the House, and on the other hand, be the people that are actually manufacturing that blockage.
Well, let me put his explanation to you, and then you tell me what you think about it. He says by proroguing, we can have a bit of a pause, hotheads can cool down. There's the potential of coming to negotiated agreements with the teacher unions, for example. There's the possibility of coming to an agreement, probably not with you, but with Tim Hudak and the Conservatives on the wage freeze bill. None of that's going to happen if the temperature rising of question period happens every day. So we prorogue and give a chance for cooler heads to prevail. What do you think of that?
Well, I mean, I think that's the government's spin on avoiding the gas plant scandal. I mean, let's face it, you don't have to prorogue the House to have a leadership race. Many a leadership races have taken place without a prorogation. And in fact, you don't have to prorogue the House to have the conversation with the public sector unions. I've been encouraging the Premier to have that conversation for months and months and months now. So neither one of those things are justifiable. What's really happening here is the government wants to put a lid on the open fill plant particularly. He doesn't want that issue to go to committee. He doesn't want his political colleagues and his party colleagues to be called before that committee to testify. And that's what this is all about, avoiding that.
Well, mind you, in the interest of fairness, if you have a leadership convention, you've got as many as, who knows, 6, 7, 8 cabinet ministers or backbenchers.
We had half of our caucus. I don't feel very sorry for them.
but not in a minority situation, I don't think, right?
Well, no, but
yours was in a majority situation, meaning if you take that many Liberal votes out of the House, I mean, there's a chance that you guys could pull the government down while they're not there.
But there is no need to take them out of the House because they're on leadership, right? Well, but they have a duty to participate in the House. I mean, I was out campaigning and I was still doing my duty in the House, as was Gilles Bisson, as was Michael Prue, as was Peter Tabbins. There's no need to have a prorogation for a leadership race to go on. If you're going to take on a leadership race, you still have your job as an MPP to do. You still have your job as a cabinet minister perhaps to do, or perhaps you step aside from that portfolio while you run for the leadership. It's one of those things. I don't believe that it's a justification for prorogation.
We did an online chat last night after Mr. McGuinty's announcement. Sean Conway, the former Liberal cabinet minister, came in, and we had a bunch of people ask us, could you and Tim Hudak go to the lieutenant governor and say, we don't agree with his desire to prorogue. We got a lot of business to do here. Take it back. Could you do that?
No, we've checked because we knew the question was coming. And in fact, no, we are not in a position to do that. Now that the prorogation has been approved, that's where we sit. And so the next thing we do is wait for the government to recall the House.
And basically what this means is there's no more question period, there's no more committees sitting. So in the absence of the House being there to do its business, what do you do?
Well, exactly, and it's pretty frustrating. I mean, we're not happy that the doors have been shuttered. I mean, you know, prorogation is an awful big word for the legislature shutting the doors and the MPPs not having to go to work there every day. So we're unhappy about that, and we're asking the people of Ontario what they think, quite frankly. We think that the people have an opinion on this as well, and we're hoping that they have their voices heard. Look, we have an economy that is still in stall mode. We have thousands, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people still out of work. We have a long-term care and a home care system that are not meeting the needs of the people of this province. We have people who are still unable to make ends meet and are feeling that they're falling behind. You know, paychecks are stagnant in this province. There are lots of big issues that we should be dealing with. And the place that you deal with the policies to address these needs, as well as the criticisms that these needs have not been addressed, is in the legislature. But with the doors shuttered, what we're going to do is go out to Ontarians and, first of all, encourage them to have their concerns raised or their voices raised around the shuttering of the legislature. legislature and, you know, indicating, I think, was what I heard last night and this morning as well, and all day today, people are not happy that the government's decided to shut the doors of the chamber for the next several months. So we want to hear from them. And we also want to do what we've been doing for a long time, which is listen to the people of this province in terms of what they want to see when it comes to change and put together some ideas to make that change happen.
Okay. In our last minute here, let me ask you this. Do you care who replaces McGuinty as premier?
At this point, I don't think so. I think the more important thing for me is to continue to connect with Ontarians and talk to them about what they would like to see for the future of this province. And I believe that we've put some great ideas on the table already. The government's actually adopted a number of the things that we've been pushing for over the years and even over the last year. And so I think we want to continue to have that conversation. That's what my focus is going to continue to be.
Okay, I get that. But my hunch is you've got to at some point be looking at that front bench and saying, well, you'd be easier to beat than you, and you'd be, I mean, you've got to be doing those kind of parlor games now, aren't you?
Well, no, because you know what, then that takes the whole thing away from what my real job is. I mean, my real job is to you know, hear from the people of Ontario and try to respond to what they're identifying as their major concerns. And I've had that focus for a long time, and I intend on keeping it.
Yeah, but you want to win, right?
Well, so I mean, you're not able to implement your ideas unless you're in the position to do so. But I still believe that a big part of the responsibility is forever connecting with the people who you purport to represent, so that when you do get in that position, that you're actually in touch with them. You're not, you know, in a bubble, as I think in some ways the premier became over the last couple of years.
Okay, let me be a week premature here in offering birthday thanks or birthday wishes, I guess I should say, to you. You're turning 50 next week.
I certainly am.
And we wish you a happy birthday.
Thank you so much,
Andrea Horwath. Good of you to join us at TVO tonight.
My pleasure.
That's the leader of the third party. I'm conveying on your behalf birthday wishes, I'm sure.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, with a few minutes to go here, I want to do, let me do this one more time. Theagenda.tvo.org is our website. We're having a live chat there right now. Your comments, your questions, put them on there and enjoy the chat. Let's look forward. Dalton McGuinty is retiring, or resigning, I shouldn't say retiring. Kind of left a little door open there, didn't he? Go federal. Anyway, that's another issue. What was he thinking? Never mind, we'll get into that another time. You're not going to say, because you're the chair of the campaign, you're not going to say because you're in journalism, so you too. Who are you supporting for Liberal leader when Dalton McGuinty leaves?
I don't know yet. I just don't know. There's an impressive array of candidates. I think we'll have to see who wants to come forward. They're going to have to resign from cabinet. The premier laid down that law, as I understood it today. Mm-hmm. So we'll have to see who wants to do this. What would I like to see, and what do I think Ontario needs? Ontario needs somebody who, and I think there's a dimension where the country needs this too, to restate the Liberal proposition, to recreate a dynamic center, focused on our core issues of healthcare and education, but also talking about jobs and growth and the environment, which has become, I think, another pillar of the Liberal offering. I think the door is open now, and the Premier has really done something good to encourage that, and I'm really hopeful there's going to be that kind of debate, because we're going to have a race that I think will be not dominated by who's got the most largest technology machine to go and identify voters in four corners of the province. It's actually going to be maybe a bit of a virtue that we're going to have something of an old-fashioned leadership, because I think there's room for ideas, and it's time for ideas. The province has changed. It's time for Liberals to change with it.
Who are you supporting?
Good answer, eh? Might
even have the benefit of being.
I'm not supporting anyone yet. I mean, I don't even know who's in the race, for example. And I think, for me, the interesting thing about this race, we were talking about this a little bit off air, is the question I have about the race is, where does austerity, where is it going to sit in the race? Because I think you look at the race, you say, well, there's an opportunity and rift inside a little bit around the issue of making, you know, do we become friends again with the teachers and others around, and do we reach out to them? And that's an opportunity to actually have a lot of people who can be a lot of troops in a leadership race versus, you know, the agenda that's in place to say we need to get this austerity, you know, budget and measures
through. Where are you on that?
Well, I think we need to, I mean, part of that why I like the prorogation is I actually think we do need a little bit of time to get the right answer, because frankly, the Liberal Party needs both, and the best part of the Liberal Party is about putting those two things together, as John said, right? Because there is that, you know, the Liberal Party has been about, historically, about managing the economy, getting the big pictures right. We've actually been the ones who have, you know, put the deficit under control, done it federally, doing it provincially, and also solving those social concerns and the needs that are out there. So
jury's out on whether you're doing it provincially. We'll see.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. Fair enough. We're in the middle of that, but the leadership race, to John's point, provides an opportunity to restate that, to get some new energy and new ideas around that, and I think that's exciting.
I want to ask you a very mischievous question, okay?
Okay, I'm
here's
ready.
The question: if you knew somebody who'd been a former chief of staff to a prime minister, who'd been an elected member of the Ontario legislature, who'd been a party president, would you think that person was a reasonable candidate for the leadership of the party?
I would be trying to encourage him into the race with all of the lures that I might have.
Help yourself. He's sitting beside you.
Yeah. I know. Well, you know what? I think, Steve, there's going to be one or two candidates from outside the caucus.
Who?
You know, some names have been suggested to me, but, you know, far be it for me to make them public.
George Smitherman?
I've heard that name.
Well, I've heard it too.
I would be surprised.
You would be surprised. Michael Bryant?
I would be surprised.
Okay, so who are the other names?
Well, I've heard the name John Wilkinson suggested.
Former cabinet minister. Lost a seat in the last election.
That's right.
Good guy.
And there may be others. I don't think we're going to get dragged Tim in, but it would be lovely. The important thing is...
Only if he promises to raise money for me, I'd do it in a sec.
The important thing is the powerful impact that a leadership debate and a leadership process has on the renewal of the party. I was part of it in 1992, and I saw that renewal happen. Lynn McLeod came out of there. She was a very strong leader. She didn't win the election in 95. The same thing happened in 1996 when Dalton became leader. And the process and encouraging as many people as possible who are thoughtful and committed to get into that race is very important.
How many ministers do you think will get in of the current group?
I think three or four.
Just three or four?
Yep.
Dwight Duncan, one of them?
I don't know.
Are you kicking the tires?
You'd never say never, but...
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
You never say never.
No, except, well, occasionally.
So you are kicking the tires.
No, not really. I don't think so. I think that the likely leader...
Think about it.
Yeah.
Think about it.
I think the likelihood... It's likely to come from the current sitting cabinet ministers, I think. There's some very good people. And for example, if I think Dwight enters the race, I will probably support him.
He's always said, when McGuinty goes, I go. Although he left a little door open.
Left a little door open today.
What are you hearing on this?
Well, the only one who hasn't or who has ruled it out is Environment Minister Jim Bradley. Not surprisingly. But yes, I mean, there are a number of cabinet ministers who may decide to run. Kathleen Wynne, Deb Matthews, Chris Bentley.
Gerald Souza.
Yes. And Dr. Eric Hoskins, who's a young, bright cabinet minister. He's got he's decided to get into politics. He is apparently 51, looks about 35, so...
Doesn't look 35.
It doesn't hurt. No,
I agree with you, Steve.
But there's a lot of really really strong people who can go. And, if the premier wants them all to resign from cabinet, I'm not sure how much of a cabinet he's going to have left by the end of it. But there may be some dark horse contenders. I'm hearing that there might be some people who aren't currently on the list who may decide to jump in. I haven't heard that, but he's another bright
young
liberal.
Didn't rule it out the other day when I asked him.
Didn't rule it out either, but as I said, only Bradley's ruled it out.
But he'd be a great cabinet minister, to move in if one of the current ones decide to run. I mean,
right.
He's clearly on the cusp of that role.
Yeah.
Yasser's the party president right now.
He is indeed.
And I'm sure he's thinking about it. As we talked about cabinet ministers, but there are caucus members as well. And you have to remember, Steve, you don't get into a leadership race just because you're bound and determined to win. Mm. Just participating in that race, adding to the dialogue, adding to the discussion
is very
important.
We have to subtract from the dialogue because we're out of time. Okay. Greg Sorbara and Tim Murphy, thanks for being there on the left, not necessarily politically, but geographically side of the table. John Duffy, Maria Babbage, thank you for being on the right, not necessarily politically, but geographically side of the table.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.